Welcome to this session about the evolution of artificial ears. My name is Lars Birger Nielsen. I'm the product manager for artificial ears here at Hortinger Brüllen Care. For the ear simulators, or artificial ears as they're called, that have been developed over the last 60 years, the acoustical impedance and the geometry of the ear simulator have been the primary focus in addressing the increasing need for realistic, accurate, and repeatable acoustic measurements. In this session, you will hear about a new and standardized fullband ear simulator that provides unprecedented realism in audio testing, reduces the development time for new acoustic products, and ensures product audio quality in the marketplace. The agenda for the session is to explain what an ear simulator is and to provide some examples of ear simulators that has been developed over the last 60 years. Then the rationale behind the evolution of ear simulators is provided, and a significant part of the session will be dedicated to presenting the work that has established the foundation for the new ear simulator and outlines the key elements of the research project that was conducted. To conclude the session, a summary of the presentation is provided together with acknowledgement and references. The purpose of an ear simulator is to replicate specific properties of the human ear. Important features of an ear simulator are the acoustic impedance, diffusion of cavities for realizing a specific acoustic impedance, design of the ear canal, pinner design, simplified or human-like pinner, control leakage or shield conditions. Other features shall be considered when embedding the ear simulator in a head and torso simulator, or HATS for short, and that is the free field response, or HRTF, which is head-related transfer functions, as well as diffuse field response. Some of the first ear simulators intended for measurements of earphones were developed in the early 1960s. The switch lucky coupler that are depicted in the slide is an example of one of these early ear simulators. In the Swiss lucky coupler, the location of cavities as well as the cylindrical shaped ear canal can be observed. In the early 1980s, the 7-11 coupler was established, and the actual design of the coupler was inspired by the Swiss lucky coupler. Since the introduction of the 7-11 coupler, it has been used for various applications such as characterization of hearing aids, earbuds, smartphones, and so on. Examples of how the 7-11 coupler are being used in different physical realizations as an ear simulator are shown in the slide. Two examples of a simplified pinner simulator with a control leakage are taken from ITU P57 and are shown on the slide. To the left, a pinner simulator with high leakage, and to the right, one with low leakage. The two different leakages are simulating a handset held loosely against the ear and a handset held firmly against the ear. In both cases, the 7-11 coupler is attached to the pinner simulator. A human-shaped pinner with a cylindrical-shaped ear canal is shown on the slide. With the 7-11 coupler attached to the pinner simulator, it forms the type 3-3 ear simulator. This ear simulator has been in use since the late 1980s. Over the years, the work on ear simulators has been focused on providing simulations of adults. However, at the beginning of the 2010s, the work on establishing an ear simulator family that would accommodate infants, babies, children, and adults was initiated in the European EMRP ears and impedance ears 2 projects. Among the outcomes of the project were prototype neonate ear simulator and demonstrator ear simulator family for three different age groups, all intended for calibration of audiology equipment for hearing assessment, including hearing screening of infants. The ear simulators mentioned in this introduction represent a limited selection of the various simulators that have been developed over the last 60 years. However, they each illustrate some of the important features of an ear simulator. For the last decade, The evolution of ear simulators has been driven by the increasing need for more realistic simulation of the acoustic impedance. Realizing that the 7-11 coupler was established in the beginning of the 1980s, where wideband performance was considered well suited for most applications, can be an issue when measuring on contemporary devices in super wideband and fullband applications. When it comes to accommodating a realistic seating of in-ear devices, the cylindrical ear canal geometry of the 7-11 coupler can be less suited for such devices. A more realistic ear canal and an acoustic impedance that would be valid for the full band application constituted the starting point for designing the next generation ear simulator. The two tasks that had to be resolved was to accurately characterize the human ear over the full audio band by determining an average human ear canal geometry using magnetic resonance imaging and by determining the corresponding average acoustic impedance for adult human ear. How this would be accomplished in an extensive research project are described in the following. Before enrolling a person in the project, the person would have to accept to be informed about any signs of illness that would be discovered during the scanning. Each person also had to have their ears cleaned to ensure that any earwax would be removed prior to performing the scanning. They also had to confirm that they had normal hearing and that they would be willing to have their ear canal filled with a contrast agent, in our case, olive oil. The contrast agent was used to allow better definition of the soft areas, as can be seen in the scan. More than 40 people, mostly European, took part in the project. Both females, 40%, and males, 60%, were scanned, and the average age of those that participated was 39 years. A scan showing the entire ear canal of one of the persons that participated in the research project are shown on the slide. The scan to the left is without contrast agent, and the scan to the right is with contrast agent. A part of the concha is also clearly visible in the scan. After completing the scanning, the MIR software extracted the 3D geometry data directly from the scans. From the 3D geometry data of the individual scans, an average adult human ear canal was established using shape analysis. The extracted 3D geometry data was then utilized by the CAD program for creating the individual ear plugs. The process that was applied is very similar to the process of creating a small in-the-ear hearing aid. The MRI scan showed the entire ear canal of one of the persons that participated. The part of the ear canal marked in green shows the shape of an individual ear plug. The part that are marked in magenta color represents the residual ear canal when the ear plug is placed in the ear canal. To the left in the same photo, the part that I'm marking magenta color represents the part of the conch that was removed during the making of the individual ear plug. The individual ear plugs have been designed to terminate approximately 90 millimeters from the eardrum of each person using a centerline measure. The part of the ear canal in green color forms the basis for an individual ear plug. The part of the ear canal in purple color represents the inner section of the ear canal. The tip on the tympanic membrane is clearly visible. To finalize the individual ear plug, two soft flexible tubes were embedded in the ear plug. These would later be connected to the microphone arrangement prior to performing the actual measurement. The other end of the tube would later form the sound port and the sound pickup respectively. The slide shows the average adult human ear canal geometry that has been established using shape analysis. To have a description of the ear canal that can be easily documented, for instance in a standard, a few cross-section areas are used. Cross-section areas in green color relates to the ear canal geometry, whereas cross-section areas in yellow color relates to the concha. The EEP marks the ear entrance point, the DRP marks the drum reference point. The cross-section area in red color is the reference plane. This reference plane is located approximately 19 mm from DRP and is used as a reference plane for the acoustical impedance measurements that will be explained in the following. A complete description of the ear canal geometry have been accomplished by a large table that can be used by relevant standards organizations like the International Telecommunication Union, Telecommunications Sector, or ITU-T for short. The ear canal and the method that are illustrated on this slide have been adopted by ITU-T and can be found in ITU-T P57 standard and has become the ear canal of a new ear simulator name, type 4.3 ear simulator. The microphone arrangement that was used for the measurements consists of two probe microphones, which can be seen on the lower left part of the slide. One microphone is acting as a sound source and the other is used as a measurement microphone. To ensure proper measurement results, several reference volume, which can be seen on the upper part of the slide, were needed to have sufficient information in the complete frequency range. In the photo, one of the reference volumes are connected to the microphone arrangement through two soft, flexible tubes. The photo to the left shows a person where the microphone arrangement has been attached to the individual earplug. The photo to the right shows the individual earplug attached to the microphone arrangement. At the end of the earplug, the two tubes can be observed. In preparation for the measurement, the person inserted the individualized earplug while seated on a simple chair and with the back supported against the wall. In this way, a stable position could be maintained during the entire measurement session. The way that the earplug has been designed prevents any kind of pressure buildup in the ear canal and at the same time provides a perfect sealing between the earplug and the wall of the ear canal. After the person had inserted the earplug, the operator connected the earplug to the microphone arrangement via the soft, flexible tubes embedded in the earplug. Even though the measurement were performed in a normal, quiet office room, a high signal-to-noise ratio was needed to achieve the required measurement quality. A measurement technique using a stepped sinusoidal as excitation combined with a narrowband tracking filter made it possible to produce measurement results that had the required quality. The measurement data that had been acquired would then be used in the calculation of the actual acoustic impedance for each person. The graphs on the slide shows the acoustical impedance for each person that were measured. The black graph shows the average acoustical impedance. A large spread in the acoustic impedance can be observed. This spread is caused by a different measurement position in each of the person's ear canal. Using propagation simulation, the data was transformed to a common reference plane. This transformation reduces the spread and improves the alignment of the resonances as shown. It is now sensible to determine an average acoustical impedance and use this as the target for the acoustical impedance of the new ear simulator. More details on how to perform measurements that will provide information about acoustical impedance are presented in another session on this conference by Mr. Søren Jønsson. The graph shows the acoustic transfer impedance of the new ear simulator as well as the associated upper and lower tolerance given by the ITU-T P57 standard. It should be noted that the difference between the average curve shown in the previous slide and the acoustic transfer impedance curve in this graph is due to the multiplication by the frequency and the normalization at 500 Hz. The new ear simulator is named Type 4.3 ear simulator and is the first member of an entire new family of Type 4 ear simulators that has been defined by ITU-T. Just like the Type 3 ear simulator family, which was introduced earlier on in this session, utilizes the 7-11 coupler design, future new members of the Type 4 family could be utilizing the Type 4.3 ear canal and acoustic impedance as common features. Into the summary. Utilizing the knowledge that was established during the research work, a new ear simulator with an average adult human ear canal geometry and a full band acoustic impedance placed at the drum position has been accomplished. In addition, the research produced knowledge on the soft to hard transition of the human ear canal as well as the oblique eardrum, which are both features that are truly replicated in the new ear simulator. Furthermore, it should be noted that the area of the microphone diaphragm used in the ear simulator is equivalent to the area of an average adult eardrum. This new ear simulator has recently been standardized by ITU in ITU-T recommendation P57. The application of the ear simulator in head and torso, or HATS for short, has been standardized by ITU and are now described in ITU-T recommendation P58. It should be acknowledged that the 7-11 coupler for many years has served as a good simulation of an average adult human ear, and that the industry have appreciated its performance and learned to understand its limitation. With the new ear simulator that has been introduced in this session, the hearing simulation is now entering a new era of unprecedented realism in audio testing. And to the acknowledgements. The microphone department in Hottinger Bøllum Care have been instrumental developing the new ear simulator, as well as the high frequency HATS type 5128, bringing the hearing simulation to the edge of what is technically possible is a great achievement. A special acknowledgement to Søren Jensen for his thorough and persistent effort in getting all details right. Also a special acknowledgement to Andreas Schumacher for all the simulation work that made the impossible possible. A special acknowledgement to Rigshospitalet in Denmark, in Copenhagen, for their effort in undertaking the task of performing the MRI scanning, as well as processing of the scans and productions of the 3D geometry data. Also, thanks to the EARS project for giving me the opportunity to disseminate results on the Universal Ear Simulator and references that are relevant for what has been explained in this session. And contact information. And we have reached the end of the session. Thank you for your attention.